Good afternoon and welcome to everyone. Thank you once again for joining us at another exciting edition of Music as Sanctuary at St. Andrew's Church. Pleasure and a privilege to have you with us this afternoon. As always, following the recital, there is soup and fellowship in the Curry Room, which you can get to by going through the exit door, hanging a right. It's at the end of the hallway on the right. Today's soup is, well, leek and potato, but I think we can call it vichyssoise because it sounds more elegant. And as always, our soups are delicious and they're also free. So it's a great joy to welcome you and to have that fellowship at the end of the concert. So please do join us for that. Today, I'm so thrilled and pleased to welcome Alistair, Ian, Kathleen, and Kerry to our concert this afternoon. These four brilliant artists, I've had the great pleasure of working with them over the course of many, many years in a couple of these instances. And it's wonderful to have them in this series. Ian's already presented a recital in this series. Kathleen is going to be doing one in the coming months. And it's going to be lovely this afternoon to explore the fantastic music of Benjamin Britten. So before we unpack all of that, let me just say that this series continues into February, March, April, May, and June. Our February lineup is now ready to go. The overarching theme of February is Black History Month, which we're going to be making music to that sentiment on two of the four Wednesdays. Ernie Cox is here on Valentine's Day with his orchestra, his friends. As you know, Ernie is a longtime jazz musician in this city, and so he's going to be presenting a very special program for that. At the end of the month, I've spent at least 15 years of my life trying to figure out how to play the ragtime music of Scott Joplin on the organ. So I prepared a number of organ transcriptions of ragtime. So you kind of have to hear it to believe it. So I hope that you will join me for that at the end of February. Next Wednesday, Susan Toman, renowned harpsichordist, and Andrew Ma, magnificent classical guitarist, are going to be presenting a concert, which they're calling Baroque Strings. Featuring our in-house harpsichord. Our harpsichord's been sitting over there for a few months. It used to belong to the eminent musician Gerald Wheeler, who bequeathed it, as it were. Well, he's not dead, but he bequeathed it in spirit to Dan Taylor, who decided to leave it here. So I'm quite happy to have it for our concert series. So that'll be next Wednesday. And then on the 21st of February, right in the middle of the month, I'm going to be presenting a special presentation of Franz Liszt, Julius Reubke, two musicians of the 19th century who had a very, very close relationship, student and teacher relationship, yet informed one another's music making in lots of ways. So a busy few weeks coming in February. Please join us for some of those concerts, if not all of them. Benjamin Britten departed from English custom in terms of his composition, in the sense that his influences, while not un-English, certainly had a continental flavor to them. One of his paramount teachers, of course, was the German serialist Anton Webern, which in many ways affected and enhanced the aesthetic of Britten's sense of tonality. He is a tonal composer, unlike Webern, but at the same time, the free tonality of the German serialists informs Britten's writing very much. And in that sense, the romanticism of Britten's writing is somewhat more detached when you compare him to the pastoralists like Vaughan Williams and so forth. And as I think I said last week when I was kind of building up the energy for this concert, the audiences have a little bit of work to do in filling in some of those emotional gaps that might at first hearing be apparent in the music, but I'll leave that for you to decide. We've organized the concert this afternoon in a sense of historical pageantry, I guess you could say, that we're going to begin with Christmas and that we're going to move briefly to the book of Exodus before returning to the story of the Epiphany. A Boy Was Born is the name of a set of choral variations that Britten wrote in the 1930s, and what the quartet is going to present is the main theme of that work. We don't have time to do all of it, but the main theme of it kind of says it all in a lot of respects. So following the interlude from his Ceremony of Carols, for which I have prepared a piano transcription, we'll be moving on to the quartet. Following that, we have the Chester Miracle Play, which Britten so magnificently set for Peter Peers and Kathleen Ferrier in 1951-1952. The dialogue between God himself and Abraham and Isaac, that great test of faith. And I'm reminded sometimes about the book of Exodus, too, that we think of Exodus as leaving to go somewhere, whereas another way perhaps to look at it is a sense of arrival. And when we think about another pasture that might be greener or another place that we want to go that might be calling us, there are often challenges along the way. And this particular test of faith is really a magnificent setting of a Chester Miracle Play, which Britten creates into a wonderful dialogue. Following that, his one and only solo organ work is his Prelude and Fugue on a Theme of Vittoria, which is loosely based on a motet by the Spanish master Eche Sacerdos Magnus. And following that, we will go to the main event, if you will, the Journey of the Magi, one of Britten's late and very dense works. It's a setting of a poem by the great T.S. Eliot. There wasn't quite enough room in the program to fit in the text, so I thought to set the tone for the concert, I would read this poem, and then we will proceed with the music. A cold coming we had of it, just the worst time of the year for a journey, and such a long journey. The ways deep, and the weather sharp, the very dead of winter. And the camels galled, sore-footed, refractory, lying down in the melting snow. There were times we regretted the summer palaces on slopes, the terraces, and the silken girls bringing sherbet. Then the camel men cursing and grumbling and running away and wanting their liquor and women. And the night fires going out and the lack of shelters and the cities hostile and the towns unfriendly and the villages dirty and charging high prices. A hard time we had of it. At the end, we preferred to travel all night, sleeping in snatches, with the voices ringing in our ears, saying that this was all folly. Then, at dawn, we came down to a temperate valley, wet, below the snow line, smelling of vegetation, with a running stream and a water mill beating the darkness, and three trees on the low sky, and an old white horse galloped away in the meadow. Then we came to a tavern with vine leaves over the lintel, six hands at an open door dicing for pieces of silver, and feet kicking the empty wineskins. But there was no information, and so we continued and arrived at evening, not a moment too soon finding the place. It was, you may say, satisfactory. All this was a long time ago, I remember, and I would do it again. But set down this, were we led all that way for birth or death? There was a birth, certainly. We had evidence and no doubt. I had seen birth and death, but had thought they were different. This birth was hard and bitter agony for us, like death, our death. We return to our places, these kingdoms, but no longer at ease here in the old dispensation, with an alien people clutching their gods. I should be glad of another death.
ask me to make, God's bidding will I not forsake, but have obedient be.
To do your bidding must be, and to bear this word for me,
pass lightly,
Among the briars' side is he. To thee
Thank you. Bursey.